were looking at those posts and how they might fit into the commission plan work side. But certainly the plan from the start is that under the assistant contract manager post and all of the operational supervising teams that sit within that, this is about minimising risks, learning and building on some of the good practice that we've had from some of the van operations so far. And from day one, we're looking at lift and shift and essentially moving those operational supervised ad teams below the assistant contract manager. They will be sat within the council, working to the same organisational structure, similar to what they are now, but within working within the council. In terms of some of the key activities within the mobilisation process, the work's been taken forward by a cross-council project team. So really importantly, we've got Wendy Nichols, who's sat there at the back. Wendy, if you put your hand up, please. So Wendy is the project manager for this, who is doing a lot of the real hard work around this. She's not only supported by people like Simon Fox and Brian Smith and those people who are doing the business as usual, but also doing this really important project as well. So we have people within the highways team that are working flat out on this. And then also, it's really important, we have key colleagues in disciplines such as legal, procurement, HR. Colin, my friend here, who has a lot of input into this project and the success around this, everyone's working really hard to make this a success. And some of those key activities around, we need to manage the demobilisation of the outgoing contract with BAM, make sure we're capturing all of that best practice and that knowledge transfer, you know, from that BAM operation. Bear in mind that we've got an operation here that left the council 9 years ago, has moved to Colas, has moved to BAM, and there's been a lot of development of good practice and thinking around that. We need to capture that. And then we need to mobilise this, all of this operation and these arrangements for the 1st of October. Really importantly, those staff, it's the BAM staff that are directly affected by this. They're in that tubing process and we need to make sure that we manage them properly as a council and we keep them properly informed and fulfil our obligations there. And importantly, as we've touched on there, the whole issue around our overall approach is around managing risks and ensuring business continuity. And with David and I and others, we're making practical decisions on an ongoing basis to minimise those risks and make sure we get it right, I think, from day one as a council. And then in terms of the mobilisation plan, so adding a bit of colour to that, you know, there's some very practical aspects to this. So it's making sure we're looking to continue to work out of the Prenton depot as the operational base. Again, a location where those BAM employees are familiar with that and setting, etc. It's a great geographical location, right on the M53 motorway. So we're looking at firming that up as the operational base. We've got that tube transfer of employees. We're also working really hard around making sure that we've got all of our vehicles and plant and equipment in place. Those subcontract arrangements we touched on before via construction line. We even need to make sure that we've got all of our stock and material supply arrangements in place for the 1st of October, as well as things like everything from IT to communication, the CRM, link to council and that, the work ordering and issuing system, etc. So we're working hard on all of that at the moment. And some of that is captured in the next steps for that critical go-live date of October. And really, just to finish on the key principles for us. So at the moment, the key aspect is around, for that 1st of October date, we absolutely need to make sure that in many ways, you know, we play safe, we manage those risks. These are important high-profile service areas that need to be running properly on day one with a smooth transition and transfer. So at the moment, we are absolutely focused on just getting it right for day one and the 1st of October. But then very much the second phase, so certainly we've got Stuart as our cabinet member at the back and through David and others. We're very much then thinking about once we get over the 1st of October, it's then about looking at how we can drive forward the innovation, the transformation of service. We've got this great opportunity here where we're bringing those people from back into the council. It's all under that council control. a great opportunity to work as one council and look at how we deliver all of that business and make sure that we're providing that, you know, that top quality service for residents and people of Will, and that's what we're really committed to do.
But I have to say to myself, you know, maybe this is a bit cynical here, being on the council for 19 years, but I'm not really sort of enthused by what's been said. I mean, we've had, you know, we've had so many problems in the past where, you know, we've had all these great ideas and they haven't come to fruition. As I said, don't get me wrong, I really appreciate the importance of the contracts going in-house. But, you know, I'm not overly impressed, I'm afraid, with that presentation.
Is there any points you want to make on that?
No, I don't know. It's not to comply with my tag
regulation. Not going down to that panel. These two ladies, the Leslie and Anita.
Thank you, Mr Chair. I would welcome the service being brought under the standard control of the council for the routine we have to work. My experience of BAM has not been as good as yours, I'm afraid, in terms of what my residents are actually telling me about the quality of work that's been done. And I would quote Lisa Rose as one example, that you go along there and you go bump, 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 bump all the way along. So I think my concern here is that we've got 25 people who are toothpick across to the council. Now, what I'd like to be able to say is that the people that are going to be 2 feet across to us are conscientious, have common sense, and they don't feel a hole here, I mean a hole there. I think all of these things most of us as councillors are frustrated about. Absolutely frustrated that you will go and you will bore 3 potholes and one is like a millimetre less than it should be, so we won't do it there. So, you know, how can you explain that to the residents? It's just not incredible. You just can't. And I just really wanted a little bit of clarification, really, if I may. On point 7.2 on page 16, you've actually said that this is a good base. The Prenton base is a good depot, good location, but it actually says it's only for the short term. And within your report, so I'd just like some clarification on that, really, what that means. I'm assuming that, I'm very simple at these things, so I'm assuming that the depot was opened by us, but the staff are not answerable to us. They're actually going to have to be 2 feet across to us because they work for another organisation. Yeah, okay. Alright, so if
could
just
make those points
then, please. No, yeah, it's indicated we'd like to come in here. Yeah, you're right, the depot, the freehold depot comes close to us, and it's probably leased at Arnold Toll, so if the depot comes back, it depends about the rate of significant improvements to the depot, and obviously we'll reach an agreement on what we need in terms of stock materials and so on for transfer. I think the report says in the short term, just to keep our options open, certainly to begin with, we want to work out of that depot. We have also consolidated other functions of the Cleveland Street Depot. The Birkin Heads of the Cleveland Street Depot, we built a new salt van there, all the gritters are located there, small vans, and also some leisure functions are maintained at the base there now as well. It did just used to be a heavy transport maintenance depot. So we'll keep our options open if we can further consolidate and release depots. Because clearly if we could release the Brent Depot and put it onto the market, we would have a cabinet and a seat that would help the council. But it's only keeping that. In terms of the potholes, I recognise your frustration with that. In fairness to BAM, time, they only go out and fill what we've asked them to fill currently, and we have the rules that we have to try and make the budget go as far as possible. I do take the point that it makes no sense in the resolution, it's based on the system. What hopefully we will have is that currently we have a measure that the planning inspectors apply, and we might be able to understand people to need one, but currently that's what their instructions are because of the overall budget and the amount of the council. Clearly what we won't have here, what we'll move to is that all these will be employees of the council. So the people asking for the work to be done and people doing the work will be employees of the council, and over time we can review all those policies and rules that we currently have. Clearly it won't be a contractual relationship, so it should be easier to make changes.
Thanks, David. I understand that, you know, obviously it needs to be cost effective, but I would imagine if you've got a team of people going to a location that's, you know, and it's only a millimetre away from being the deck, so it would make sense to fill our holes as well.
Thanks, Steve, then David, and yourself.
Thanks, Chair. First question was about the depot, which is stolen from me anyway. The second question, on one of your slide delivery services and the urgent work, on the reactive side, you have items like emergency call out, dangerous total payment, but the response time is 2 hours, 24/7 days. Surely if any of us asking that we want 2 hours, we would want 24 hours or 7 days. Is there a reason that those extended times are in there for dangerous stuff, emergency work?
Yeah, through you, Chair, it will depend on the nature of the issue and the defect that's reported. So it will be that certain things that are in danger to public health and life will be on that 2 hour. We then have, you know, there'll be very significant potholes and things of that nature will be on what we call a P1 or 24-hour response. And then there may be potholes of a certain size that might be deteriorating where an assessment has been looked at by the inspector who's gone out there quickly, but his technical judgment is that we can actually do a repair within seven days. The relevance of that is when these instances are inspected, they're getting the balance between the need for an emergency and emergent response. And obviously, if work can be packaged together so that it's just done within a week or a fortnight or a month, it enables the contracting side to carry things out more efficiently and essentially put a package of work that's done in a period of time. But very importantly, the inspector, each one of those would be looked at, and that's where the time scales come from.
Thank you.
David?
Yes,
thank
you, Chair. Following on from what Vijay said, some of us have had major concerns about the quality of the work undertaken by BAM over the years, and having spent a lot of time in the construction industry myself, I'm just hoping that if we bring it back in-house, there'll be two other elements brought into it. As Anita has said, we are tubing 25 of these people across there. It's not so much the operatives that I'm worried about, it's their supervision. We must ensure that they are adequately and properly supervised by people who know what they're doing, because otherwise it will be a mess. And the second thing associated with that is there a mechanism by which we have a form of the old clerk works idea where somebody is going to go along afterwards and make sure that what is supposed to have been done has actually been done? Because that is again an element to making sure that the quality of what we pay for, the quality of what we get, is down to value for money. And I'm concerned about that, particularly with regard to the problem that's been alluded to with the 25 to the operatives, who I'm sure are absolutely lovely chaps, but if they're not supervised properly and they're not checked upon the quality of it, it'll be a problem.
Before you come in there, can I just clarify that, David? You're asking who's supervising the supervisors?
What?
As well as everyone
else. Well, really, what I'm saying is, I'm assuming, along with all this, that there are proper supervisors in place, and not only that, but their work is being checked by either the supervisor themselves or another element who are going to come across the network, but what is being done is done properly. I think it's so important in my experience, the 40 years of construction, for example, that we've got to make sure that somebody is checking that what is being done is being done properly.
Okay. Yeah, I think I'm happy to reassure you, Mark and I have met with the BAM staff yesterday, in fact, many of them worked for the council before they transferred to Colas. They're what's expected of them. We had a really open discussion with them. Mark did this presentation and it was very well received. And they will be willing to suit. They haven't yet had to say it's stupid, so we have to wait and see. But certainly the implications are that supervision will be transferring along with the employees who have to do the work. Simply within the council, we will still have our highway inspector team who will monitor the work and check on what has been done as well. In the longer term, we might want to bring those two teams together, but in the short term, what Mark has described is we'll lift and shift with our people as an operating unit, our highway inspector will monitor the work still and check if it's finished. Also, that then is supervision within the band team.
Thank you. Chair, David's absolutely covered it, but I think in terms of some of those issues around quality and workmanship, there's obviously, in a very simple term, we're removing one degree of separation, as it were, isn't it? So just to bring that to life, so on the routine reactive side, you know, so far through the ban arrangement, we have those operatives, those employees carrying out that kind of work, you know, reporting into to essentially what was a contract arrangement. Obviously those people, those supervisors and that assistant contract manager is going to be plugged directly into the management of delivery service on the day we're there. So there's that very direct control over how we're doing things. And I think importantly, picking up the comment by Councillor Leach before around even on the planned structural type work site where we spend a lot of money and it is work that's carried out by external contractors. The arrangement under BAM was that we issued the work to them through that strategic contract. They would then have subcontractors in place. So there's that extra degree of separation in terms of control. When this arrangement is in place, that kind of work, it might be carried out by the same kind of external contractors, but it's going to be supervised and managed and administered directly by the people in that commission service side of things with Clerk of Works and inspectors and those kind of people. So we've essentially removed the degree of separation, if that makes sense, which should give us that greater degree of influence.
And the only other thing I'd add to what Mark has said is we Mark and myself, Nicky Butterworth and some colleagues from procurement, we've held two sessions. The first one was with the private contractors who currently do work, as Mark's described, for us in the plan. We had a session with them and set out all the instructions and set out the opportunities they were looking for work. Then the second session, they're mainly regional, and there's some regional connections. And then we had a second session where we invited a more open session for all the contractors who may not currently do work through the plan, who actually could be interested. So we've had those two sessions as well.
Thank you, Dave.
Thank you very much, Chair. Most of my questions have been partially answered. David just partially answered one because I had a question was who are you looking for as partners in relation to this point of Mark. The funding for the mobilisation plan, which quite swiftly shot over somewhere on the slideshow, but there's quite a bit of information there like new IT stuff and plant hire and stuff. Plant hire or buying new materials. And the one point that David did make is was the fix for the budget. Now when we transferred from the local authority to the private sector, it was at a saving. Now we're reversing back again at a saving. I'd love to know where the savings are coming from and where they'll be. I hope it's not out of the budget because there are, as it says in 7.3, there will be one-off payments that have to be made in relation to getting these things up and running. So am I looking at a fixed figure of what was it, 6 million plus for the two parts that we look after in relation to this being reduced to 5.5 million or 5 million because we need a million to get new plants or new equipment or new computers? That's the question. We're looking to improve, and I'm happy going on with this, I think it's okay. But are we going to struggle for a couple of years and not got what get delivered what we hope to be delivered because the funding will be used for other things?
I think that there will be some additional costs to the transfer fee. We have to reach a commercial settlement with BAM and we're giving a lot of evidence, discussions with other people with some months now. We feel we're approaching the conclusion of that. also need to have a full understanding of how many staff to be over. So clearly in the short term there could be some additional cost. We can review that as we go along, but the other thing is that clearly we're currently in a commercial contract, so somewhere in that commercial contract, for all the right reasons in the commercial contract, the contractor needs to make a profit. Clearly that would no longer apply because it would be the council doing work for the council. So I think that there are a number of things to balance up. I suspect it will be some months before we get the full picture, but again, we have to bring the report back. In terms of things like IT, we intend to make use of existing resources as much as we can.
Well, I did say in the report
I mean, I think we will be discussing with BAM that they will leave the depots they've included, that they will maintain the current stock levels of all the things they need. The one thing they will take with them is their computers, but apart from that, we should just be able to walk in and carry on as normal.
So, David, well, can I just add to that? Can we see some figures of how much this is going? I think that's what you were asking, Dave, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Can we see some figures about how much it's going to cost the council and the diminishing budgets? Any further costs, I think you were alluding to, Dave.
Yeah,
further costs that are incurred.
The 19th needs to break.
I think we as a committee would like to have sight.
Really, we're not in a position yet where we've got an agreed financial close on the existing contract, and we obviously need to ascertain the things we need for the staff to be told. We'll report back when we've got all that information. Our intention is to at least run the contract at its current costs and hopefully improve on that. It may take us a year to get it. Dependent again on how the opportunity begins with. One final thing, what I should say is, when this contract went out 10 years ago, they were a great, it was a much bigger workforce than it's too
long.
Thank you,
Chair.
My question was, initial question was similar to what Dave just asked, really, because we all remember the days of the DLO with Direct Labour. And that's one of the reasons, not all the reasons, that was one of the main reasons we went out to save money to do a private contract, and now here we are. Bring them all back in. I really hope it works. I mean, I think what is really important as well is obviously customer satisfaction, because there is really no hiding place in this at the moment. You know, the reputation of the council already hangs in the balance in a number of areas. We cannot let this go wrong for whatever reason, because this is what people see when they open their front doors, and we all know. And if we say that we're bringing it out, bringing it back all into the council, I can imagine that there will be echoes, not from me, but from residents saying, well, it's just jobs for the boys, they're looking after themselves, and nothing has improved. That can't happen. As I say, there is no hiding place in this. We cannot blame outside contractors who we've brought to do the job for us if the council are actually letting these contracts to the subcontractors, and we are as well. And the other reassurance I want, that there will be no loss from the system for those jobs that are in, and I'd love to think that all the requests that I and many members have put in would all be dealt with before hand over, but that's not going to happen. I appreciate that for all sorts of reasons. But that information, whether it be by the CRM system or whether it be by direct to offices, which I know we shouldn't do, but we do because we're frustrated by CRM, and that's another issue, but there will be no loss of those.
No, we're going to carry on placing work as usual. There won't be any period where we look down and don't place work orders in, say, August or September. We're going to carry on working as normal, and we'll pick up on the 1st of October where they are. On the side of, it's worth remembering, as Mark said, this is a £6 million bulk of work. £4 million companies placed with outside contractors. We've got plans to change that. So the work is currently done by external contractors like the White Rhino and the major research, and so we'll still be done by external contractors.
Anyone else? No? Mark, I'd like to thank you for that presentation. I'd just like to say, are you confident that the date you got in October that we're going to hand over, I assume that there's a completion date with BAM, and then we'll take over, which will be seamless. How confident are you? Because we're in July now, October's only a few weeks away, it's not that long away.
Are we fully confident that we're going to handle this?
I'm happy to give you a straight answer on that, Chair. So in terms of all of those aspects of the mobilisation, we're working really hard. I have a really good degree of confidence around all of that. We're working hard as we speak, so it's fair to say that, you know, with Wendy and the team, we've got some critical activities over the coming weeks, so we need to get out there on construction line for that subcontract arrangement. That's one of the big things we need to do. But all of those other bits, we've very much adopted this principle of making sure that we are playing safe. We've got a depot that the workforce is going to be familiar with. David has already helpfully made some decisions around things like vehicles and other things, David, where we're making sure that we've got the right kit and we're not taking risks around trying to order new pieces of plant. On things like the winter maintenance service that we've not touched on, we're looking at very much the same kind of staffing and approach around that. So we've worked hard to minimise those risks and issues, and we've made decisions on that basis, on the basis that you know, this is really important.
Right
for the 1st of October, and that service
continuity is going to be there. Just the meeting, we've got a fortnightly meeting, that the working group of the council now in the role of the supervisor on BAM, who's working with us on a seconded basis on that. And as Mark said, we're trying to do as many things as we can to prepare for the October and December period. We've filled the salt ground, we've bought some additional plant in so that we don't have to go and buy it in the open market. So as Mark said, the depot is ours, it's going to be left as it is. BAM will keep the stocks of materials that they need, that we need, the temporary pothole repair materials and so on, they'll maintain the stock levels. I'm sure there'll be some hiccups, but we are planning for it as best as we can. And things like all those factors help us, because if we're not switching to a brand new system in a brand new depot with a brand new team of people, the number of factors which should help us.
Can I just reiterate on the cost implications? I really would like to see the, because of the constraints on the budget and the shrinking of the budget, this committee would really like to see the cost implications and how much it cost us, the overall idea of the revenue. And I've got to say before I'm closing on this, I think the BAM motor contract has been an absolute disaster. Yeah. I've seen the quality of our roads diminish over the last few years, not only in my ward, but right across the borough.